Greetings, children. The topic that we are going to learn today is the second part of circulatory system. Already in first part we learn about why do we need circulation, and we learn about the circulating fluids in our body, and we discussed about the characteristics of blood, functions of blood, and we started discussing about, started learning about composition of blood and about cellular elements. Just a gist I have given in the last class. So now we are going to learn in detail about the cellular elements of blood. Okay, you are going to learn in detail about this cellular elements of blood. So in cellular elements, there are three different kind of cellular element. They are erythrocytes, leukocytes and thrombocytes. Erythrocytes are nothing but the red blood corpuscles, are RBC. Leukocytes are WBC or white blood corpuscles, and thrombocytes are the blood platelets. So first we are going to learn in detail about the erythrocytes. So these erythrocytes are, let me tell it as RBC. So these RBC are the oxygen carrier of our blood. They are the one responsible for transport of oxygen from the lungs to each and every cell of our body. And their shape is, they are very minute, and they are so small, like their diameter is 7 micron. 1 micron, you know that 1 micron is 1/1000 millimeter. So their diameter is 7 micron is their diameter. So that much small they are, and their shape is biconcave. Biconcave means, first when the RBC, this is a kind of structural adaptation that you could see in RBC. When RBC is newly formed, when RBC is newly produced, the RBC would be in the shape of a spear. Okay, like it would be like a small ball, or like the shape of a small spear. And this RBC, when it loses its nucleus, that has its nucleus, when it loses its nucleus while it grow mature, that gains the shape of this biconcave nature or biconcave shape. Biconcave means you can see this concavity on both this upside and downside of this spear shaped structure. So this is biconcave, this is a mature RBC's shape. Why do they get such a shape? This is a structural adaptation, I said first itself. So why do they get such an adaptation? When nucleus is found in this part, it will be in the shape of a spear one. It will be in the shape of a ball shaped structure. So, when compared with the ball shaped structure, this concavity, this flatness in the center, and also the projection or thick part in the periphery will be giving more surface area when they wanted to attach with oxygen. This concavity on both the sides will be giving too much surface area to absorb or to attach with more number of oxygen. So, this is what the structural adaptation RBC possess. So to hold more oxygen, and also one more thing, they can squeeze their body, they can reduce their size, they can go shrink, and they can get into the blood capillaries, smaller blood capillaries, anywhere in the body part they can go into, and in an easier and faster way. So they wanted to make their body flexible by doing some structural adaptation. So this is one such structural adaptation. And what is the shape? If there is a question about shape of RBC, you need to go with biconcave shape. Okay, and I gave you the reason also why they are in biconcave shape. And this RBC, the production of RBC and the destruction of RBC, when we are talking about the life of RBC, RBC is produced in the long bone marrow, that is the maximum one in an adult one. When in case of embryo, embryo means when a baby is formed in the womb, when the baby is in a mother's womb, that is known as embryo stage. So when an organism is in embryo stage, when a human baby is in an embryo stage, the RBC is being produced by spleen, and liver will also do that work. So spleen and liver is responsible for the production of RBC in embryo. In adult, spleen and liver will continue production, and along with that, long bone marrow will also be doing that work. In long bone marrow, which are the long bone marrows involved in this is, our rib cage bone will be involved in it, and also the breast bone and the Ilium bone of our pelvic girdle will also be doing that. You have studied that in the last year, ilium bone. So ilium bone is also responsible for the production of RBC. So this is about the production. Now, how long an RBC can survive? Right, their lifespan. Their lifespan is about 120 days. Why the lifespan is so strict like that? Let me explain that to you. The mature RBC, here you can see that the mature RBC doesn't have any nucleus. That indirectly means that when an RBC is newly produced, it has a nucleus. Young RBC possesses a nucleus, it has a nucleus. But the mature RBC doesn't have a nucleus. And it doesn't have any cell organelle like mitochondria and endoplasmic reticulum. There is a reason for all these things. When nucleus is present in RBC, RBC will be in the shape of a spear. When it loses the nucleus, RBC gains that biconcave shape to increase larger surface area. So as they are losing the nucleus, they are increasing, their surface area becomes more. Their surface area is more so that they can absorb more amount of oxygen. And one more reason, when nucleus is present in an RBC, RBC will take care of its own self. RBC will be doing its own function when it possesses a nucleus of its own. As nucleus means, it directly means that it has a DNA, it has an RNA, it has its own components, so they will be doing their own function to stop RBC doing its own function. And also to accommodate more oxygen to increase larger surface area, nucleus is getting disintegrated in the RBC when it is maturing. The second organelle, mitochondria. When it is present in a cell, mitochondria, you know that organelle is responsible for cellular respiration. If mitochondria is present in an organelle, in a RBC, RBC will use up the oxygen what it is supposed to transport. Okay, if you are asking someone to pass on a thing, carry a thing from one place to another, you are asking that person to move it from one place to another. If that person is consuming that part, consuming, or if the person is utilizing that, it's of no use. The efficiency is going low. So to stop that, there is no mitochondria in the RBC, so that the RBC will not utilize oxygen for itself. It will be giving completely to some other cells. Okay, and then the third organelle is endoplasmic reticulum. Endoplasmic reticulum is otherwise termed as the cellular skeleton. Remember that. So endoplasmic reticulum, if it is found in a structure, the structure will become rigid. It will become very strong. So if endoplasmic reticulum is present, RBC will be strong. But RBC shouldn't be strong, because RBC has to squeeze its body. It has to go through the smallest blood capillaries. It has to be very flexible. So to increase the flexibility of RBC, endoplasmic reticulum will also be disintegrated. Okay. So this is the main three give reason sort of question from this lesson. Mature RBC doesn't have a nucleus, why? Mature RBC doesn't have a mitochondria, why? Or mature RBC doesn't have ER, why? Okay. And I'll tell you one secret. Why the average lifespan is 120 days. It's not given in your book. Let it be there with you. So why the lifespan is 120 days? Why it is fixed as 120 days? Why it is not repairing itself? The cell repairing is majorly because of DNA which is present in the cell. As RBC doesn't have any nucleus, as RBC doesn't have any organelle to correct itself or to repair itself, its lifespan is also getting over by 120 days. Okay, they can't produce any protein to repair. They can't produce any enzymes to repair. So their lifespan is 120 days. After 120 days, at the time of 120 days, all their enzymes, proteins will get used up and it will become like very old, worn out. They have to be destroyed. Now, what happened at the time of destruction, or where is being destroyed? This RBC will be destroyed in the spleen and liver. RBC is destroyed in the spleen and liver. Even though the maximum credit goes to spleen, liver is the one where it is being processed. Okay, spleen is the organ where the destruction actually happens. Spleen is the organ which is responsible for the quality control of our bloodstream. okay, that you have to be very clear about. Spleen is the organ which is responsible for clearing up of all the worn out cells of our blood. It's the one which is maintaining the quality of our blood. As like kidney, this is also maintaining the quality of our blood. So liver is the place where this worn out parts are being processed. Okay, so it's like when in liver, the RBC which is enclosing the major part is hemoglobin. So when RBC is worn out, RBC is crossing its 120 days, or when it is crossing the age, it has to be killed. At that time, this RBC will be split into its components. It will be splitting into its protein, its hemoglobin part, and the hemoglobin will be disintegrated into heme part and globin part. Heme and globin part. Hemoglobin will be disintegrated into heme and globin part. Okay, this hemoglobin will be disintegrated into heme part. Can you see that this spelling? This is heme. Heme part means the iron part, and globin means the protein part. So this heme and globin part will be separated, and this heme part will be staying in the liver itself, because it's been stored in the liver itself. That's why we used to say that liver is a part which is rich in iron. So liver, this hemoglobin from the iron from the hemoglobin, that is heme, is stored in the liver. And what happens to the globin is, this will be later transformed or produced into bilirubin, that is a bile pigment. And this bile pigment will be excreted out as in case of like in the fecal matter or through urochrome formation, this will be going out of our body. So that is what globin part. And apart from these two, hemoglobin is having one more part, that is known as porphyrin. Porphyrin is just a ring structure which is giving the red color nature for the molecule. Okay, porphyrin is the pigment which is responsible for giving the red color thing. This is for competitive exam. This is not in your syllabus. This is for your competitive exam. Porphyrin is the component which is present in your hemoglobin, which is giving the red color. Okay, this is responsible for the red color. The red color pigment is porphyrin, right? And then, now in the case of destruction, how much amount of RBC will get destroyed? So there is a random calculation. In a total population of RBC, nearly 1% of RBC is destroyed at each day, or normal at every day, 1% of RBC is destroyed. So how much would be that 1% is a huge amount. You can see like 2 crore, nearly some 2 crore of RBC will get destroyed at every minute. Okay, so totally it forms 1% of total erythrocytes, which is being destroyed in every day. So you know that it's very huge number. In every minute, 2 crores of RBC. So you just assume that this is so huge amount, right? Now, there are two abnormal conditions. This is for your term learning. There are two abnormal conditions. One is abnormal increase in RBC, which is termed as polycythemia. Abnormal increase in RBC is termed as polycythemia. An abnormal decrease in RBC is known as erythropenia. Okay, abnormal increase is polycythemia and abnormal decrease is erythropenia. Okay, so these two are for your term learning process. And then this RBC count, there are some general facts that RBC count will go low while we are sleeping, because at the time we sleep, most of the organelles won't do the work. So most of the organelles doesn't require oxygen. So there will be destruction rate would be more, and production rate will also be very low. So there is a lower count of like nearly some 5% RBC count will be lower at the time we sleep. Okay, and then how much amount of RBC will be there? Nearly some 5 to 6 million count will be there in a adult man. Okay, adult man possesses 5 to 6 million of RBC in 1 cubic millimeter of blood. That is so important. In 1 cubic millimeter of blood, in a normal healthy adult man, 5 to 6 million would be there. And in a normal healthy adult female, it would be 4 to 5. That means men are having too much of hemoglobin than RBC than the female. Female will be having 4 to 5 million per cubic millimeter of blood, and the children will be having little less, but newborn baby will be having too much, like they will be having more than 6 to 7 millions of RBC count per cubic millimeter, 6 to 7 million of RBC, that is more than an adult human men blood RBC count. Okay, so that's why they are so pinkish in color. You could see that they are like so pinkish and they are so soft. So that pinkish nature is because of too much of RBC, hemoglobin content in their body. Right, so this is about RBC and about hemoglobin. Now we are going to hemoglobin part. So this hemoglobin is the respiratory pigment. Now you may wonder, what is the connection between RBC and hemoglobin? RBC is the thing which is like a bag of membrane which is having hemoglobin and some solutions and some ions, some materials inside, some matrix inside. Okay, so RBC is like one organelle. And hemoglobin is one part, major part of this RBC. RBC contains hemoglobin as the major part. And hemoglobin is the respiratory pigment found inside the RBC. Hemoglobin is the respiratory pigment. This is very huge in an RBC. This is very huge. And this is formed by, already I told you that hemin part, that is iron part, and also the globin part, which is protein part. And this hemoglobin is having a nature to combine with gas. When in case of oxygen, it combines with oxygen to form oxyhemoglobin, but oxygen it doesn't form a stable compound. It's very highly unstable compound. So when it finds a cell with less oxygen, immediately this oxygen will be donated. The hemoglobin will be donating this oxygen to the cell which is lacking oxygen. Okay, so they are not establishing a very good bonding with the oxygen. And carbon dioxide is not like that. Carbon dioxide, the bonding is a little bit stronger than oxyhemoglobin. So oxyhemoglobin can combine with carbon dioxide, but one condition, a carbon dioxide can't take too much of carbon dioxide. Very little amount of carbon dioxide only it can take. Now, this carbon monoxide is having too much affinity towards hemoglobin, or hemoglobin is too highly high in love with carbon monoxide. So whenever there is carbon monoxide, this carbon monoxide and hemoglobin will form a compound called carboxyhemoglobin. This is very, very, very important for you. This is carboxyhemoglobin. You have to learn totally three terms in this hemoglobin: oxyhemoglobin, carbaminohemoglobin. I didn't give it here. Wait a sec. It is carbaminohemoglobin. You have to learn totally three words. I said oxyhemoglobin is hemoglobin with oxygen. Carbaminohemoglobin is hemoglobin with carbon dioxide. Already I said about these two, oxyhemoglobin, in previous class. Oxyhemoglobin and carbaminohemoglobin. And one more thing is carboxyhemoglobin. Carboxyhemoglobin is, here it is, carboxyhemoglobin is hemoglobin with carbon monoxide, which is forming a very stable compound, which is actually a very strong affinity is there between these two molecules. So it forms a very strong stable compound. And this carboxyhemoglobin is actually creating carbon monoxide poisoning in our blood, which is dangerous to our body. So when people are living near the chimneys, or when people are stuck up with the chimneys, or like in industries and all, if they are staying near the chimneys, those who are cleaning up the chimneys, no, those people will be getting this carbon monoxide poisoning, and it's really dangerous. Okay, so that is what carboxyhemoglobin. This is a highly stable compound. So in hemoglobin, we are learning about these facts. Okay. Now, the second part is WBC or leukocytes. Yes. So these leukocytes, they do have a nucleus. It's not like RBC. They have a solid nucleus. And why we are stressing on nucleus is, as they possess nucleus, they can take care of their own self. But still, they don't have that much of lifespan. Their lifespan is just 14 days. Okay? Their leukocytes, their lifespan is just 14 days. Okay? Now, they don't have a hemoglobin, or they don't have a pigment with them. And they are amoeboid in shape, and they can produce pseudopodia. As they are like amoeboid in shape, they can produce pseudopodia like amoeba. And why do they produce the pseudopodia like amoeba is, because of pseudopodia, they can invade, they can cover the pathogen, they can swallow the pathogen, and they can kill the pathogen by engulfing them. Okay, so that is the nature of these leukocytes. These leukocytes are majorly, you would have heard about the WCC is majorly responsible for immune development of our body. So this immunity, how it is being developed, it can be developed by attaining its functions. Like WBC has to do some 3-4 function, which is all common. All these things are doing the function to make the body so strong, its immunity has to be strong. So they can produce antibody, they will be producing antitoxins, they will be, if there is any foreign protein enters into our body, like for example this corona itself, when the new protein or when new organism is entering into our body, that will be treated as antigen, and the body will be, our body will be producing an anti-protein for that, that is known as antibody. So this antibody production is majorly responsible, is majorly being produced by the WBC cells. And then what happens to the pathogen when this detects the pathogen? It can, sometimes it can engulf or it can swallow the pathogen, as like a python swallows its prey, it can swallow the pathogen. And then it can, with the help of its digestive enzymes, it will digest it completely. Okay, so these are all the major functions which is being done by the WBC cells in our body. So it is being attained by two major processes. Okay, all this function of WBC is majorly attained by two major processes. What are the processes? The first process is diapedesis. Okay, diapedesis. This diapedesis means, the definition is here, oozing out of WBC through walls of capillaries. The capillary walls are epithelial cells. Capillary walls are epithelial cells. They are not like the other blood vessels. Capillary walls are not like artery wall or vein wall. They are simply made up of one single membrane cell thickness. Okay, they are like so poor arrangement of cells. Why do they have that sort of very poor arrangement of cellular structure is, they wanted to allow the diffusion of substances. So when capillaries are in contact with tissue fluid or when they are contact with lymph fluid, this WBC used to easily go out and come in. Okay, so that movement is known as oozing out. Oozing out means they are simply like how an octopus used to go out. Like, you would have seen the videos of octopus when they are moving out through small opening. They will be just squeezing their body and they will be easily going through that way, somewhat like a jelly-like substance, they will be moving out. So that is known as oozing out. So this oozing out of WBC is happening through the capillary walls. So that process of oozing out of WBC through capillary walls is known as diapedesis. This is the first process, it's going out. And when it goes out, what happens is, this WBC will develop pseudopodia, and that will engulf the pathogen, and the pathogen will get completely digested by the WBC cell. So that process is known as phagocytosis. You want to know the literal meaning of the word phagocytosis? Phagocytosis is actually cell eating. Okay, the cell is, this WBC cell is going to eat the pathogen. So that is what phagocytosis. Okay, so these are the two processes by which WBC is attaining the function of providing immunity. Now we are going into the classification. So classification of WBC, majorly it's being classified into two aspects, or in, on the basis of its shape and characteristics, we are categorizing that into two major categories. Okay, what are the two major categories? One is granulocyte and the other one is agranulocyte. Split the word and know the meaning. Granulocyte, site for cell, granulo for granules. Granules means small pebble sort of structure. Granules, that's an English word. I guess you can understand that the word granule. Laddu is composed of granules, right? So the granule means small parts, small bits. So granulocytes means, in this kind of cells, in the cell cytoplasm, you could see small granules. I'll show you the picture. This is granulocyte. This is a granulocyte and this is also a granulocyte. Can you see the small granules in the cell cytoplasm? Small pebble sort of structure, small granules. So this is granulocyte, and here these are agranulocytes. Agranulocytes means they don't have such a granule structure in their cell cytoplasm. So granulocytes and agranulocytes are the two major category of WBC or leukocytes. And now, what is the other one characteristic? On what characteristics we are categorizing this into granular and agranulocyte? One is based on the granules present in the cell cytoplasm, and the other one is based on its nucleus. Granulocytes have lobed nucleus. I'll show you the picture. Granulocytes have lobed nucleus. You can see lobes of nucleus. Here one lobe, here another lobe. Lobe means they are branched, they are divided. Here you can see that in neutrophil, right? So nearly three lobes are here. Here in basophil, you can see somewhat it's branched. It's not clear. It's like obliquely branched, right? So this is, nucleus is lobed in granulocytes and nucleus is not lobed in agranulocytes. So these two are the differentiate between points between granulocytes and agranulocytes, right? And then, now we are going into the subcategorization. So granulocytes are again categorized into three major cells. They are neutrophils, eosinophils and basophils. Neutro, eosino and basophils. Okay, so this granulocytes have this suffix phil. Neutrophil, basophil and eosinophil. Why do they got such a name? That is because of their stain. Stain means coloring substance, coloring solution, stain, right? So when we color the blood corpuscle, this WBC, if they are getting stained with neutral solution, they are termed as neutrophil. Neutral stains the neutrophil. And eosinophil means they will get the stain with eosin, which is an acidic dye. Eosin, the spelling is up to this. Eosin. Eosin is an acidic dye. Eosin. If the WBC is getting stained with eosin, then it is termed as eosinophil. And the next one is basophil, which is getting the stain from basic dye. There are so many basic dyes. Best known example is methylene blue. So they are being categorized on the basis of their dye, what we are using or what they are accepting. So this will get stained with neutral stain, and this will get stained with eosin, which is a acidic stain. This will get stained with the basic stain. Okay, here lymphocytes, these cells are mostly or predominantly found in the lymph vessel, so they are called lymphocytes. And monocytes means they are an individual one, like they will be transforming into some other substance at the time of its work. Okay, so these are the subcategories. Now we will go learn the characteristics of this all. So first, neutrophil is the one which possesses nearly 3 to 4 lobe, right? It's having 3 to 4 lobe. Now they do phagocytosis. Almost all the WBC used to do phagocytosis, and they are the one which is doing phagocytosis in a very better way. And then the next one, eosinophil, which is getting stained with eosin. And eosinophil, it is responsible for allergy correction. When there is allergy, when a person is getting allergy, at that time you can check the blood count, the person's eosinophil count would be so high. Okay, you would have heard about the word eosinophilia. That is nothing but the condition when the eosinophil count is so high. So eosinophils are the one which will be increasing dramatically at the time of allergies. And they are responsible for the secretion of antitoxins. And eosinophils are, responsible for the allergy. They are connected with allergy, right? And then the nucleus is too lobed. Eosinophil's nucleus is too lobed, right? And then the next one, basophil, which is getting stained with the basic stain. And about basophil, the key word that we need to learn is it is responsible for the production of histamine. This is important, the production of histamine. Histamine production is at the time of infection. Histamine production would be reported in our blood, in our body. Histamine production would be high at the time of infection. And this histamine will be later responsible for the inflammation. Inflammation means swelling up. Even if it a mosquito bites, there will be a swelling. That is known as inflammation. So histamine will be produced at the time of infection, and which will be later producing the inflammation. So basophil is responsible for this histamine production and inflammation formation. And the basophil's nucleus is indistinctly lobed. That means it is lobed, of course, but you can't say whether it is producing 3-lobe or 4-lobe. Now you can see 1, 2, 3, 4 sort of lobes are there, right? They are like abnormal lobe. And the next one is agranulocytes. In agranulocytes, just only two, lymphocyte and monocyte. I said lymphocytes are mostly found in the lymph, and that's why they got such a term. And they are the smallest WBC. This is for your 1 marks, like picky question. They are the smallest WBC cells. Lymphocytes are the smallest WBC cells. And they are responsible for the production of antibodies. The lymphocytes are responsible for antibody production. Already you have studied that antitoxins are being produced by eosinophil and antibody production is by lymphocytes. You have to go through the key very carefully. And lymphocytes are, they have a single large nucleus. And what about monocytes? These are also having single large nucleus, but the nucleus is kidney shaped one. That is the difference between these two. And apart from that, monocytes are responsible. They are doing their function at the site of infection. When there is a case of infection, these monocytes will be produced and they will be transforming into macrophages. Macrophages means a cell which will be doing phagocytosis. Somewhat like all the WBC cells, macrophages will be produced. Macrophages means they are bigger cells which will be doing phagocytosis. Okay, so these macrophages are produced. So that's it about monocytes too. So lymphocytes and monocytes are coming under the agranulocytes. And the next cell organelle that we need to learn about is platelets. About platelets we will be learning in the next class. Okay, now we can go with a summary. What are the things we have learned today? We learned about erythrocytes, the shape, why do they have such a shape, why do they don't have a nucleus, mitochondria and endoplasmic reticulum, why their lifespan is 120 days, how much amount is being destroyed and where it is destroyed, right? And abnormal increase and abnormal decrease of RBC. Yeah, in case of WBC, the abnormal increase of WBC is leukemia and abnormal decrease of WBC is leukopenia. Okay, for WBC, abnormal increase is leukemia and in decrease is leukopenia. Somewhat like erythropenia, that is leukopenia. Here it is polycythemia and there it is leukemia. Leukemia is nothing but that blood cancer. Okay, so abnormal increase in RBC and WBC, you can take note of abnormal increase in WBC, abnormal decrease in WBC too. Okay, right. And one more information, this is not in your syllabus. So this is, the first point is there in your syllabus, but this story, the second one is not there in your syllabus. Those who are interested to learn biology, please take note of this. Erythropoiesis is formation of RBC. This is in your syllabus. Erythropoiesis is formation of RBC. Formation of RBC. We learned that the formation of RBC happens in the long bone marrow and also in the liver and also in the spleen. So erythropoiesis is the process of formation of RBC. Now, who is responsible for this erythropoiesis? That is a hormone called erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is the hormone which is responsible for erythropoiesis. And who is responsible for the production of this hormone is juxtaglomerular cells of kidney. This is not in your book. This point is not there in your book. Juxtaglomerular cells of kidney is responsible for erythropoietin production. And under what condition this juxtaglomerular cells will get the trigger to produce this erythropoietin is when our body experiences no oxygen. When our body experiences oxygen deficit, this juxtaglomerular cells will be producing this erythropoietin. Erythropoietin will be enhancing erythropoiesis. Okay, so under two conditions, like when a person is having anemia or a person is under condition of hypoxia, there is no oxygen supply from environment or because of crowded environment or because of high altitude or something, if oxygen is very less supplied to the body, that condition is known as hypoxia. And then other one is anemia, that is no hemoglobin or low hemoglobin content. And one more thing is when androgen production is more. How do androgen production becomes more? Androgen production can be common in both men and women. Androgen is a kind of sex hormone, but androgen production can be doing work at the time when person gets hype, like when a person is getting distressed or when a person is getting stressed some situations, or when a person is doing vigorous exercises. So those sort of thing, like muscle exercises are there, like those sort of condition also androgen production becomes more. So at that time, blood supply has to be given more to the particular body part or throughout the body, or to the heart, RBC has to be supplying more oxygen. For that, there is a natural emergency condition, like when these three situations happen, the juxtaglomerular cells has to produce erythropoietin, and erythropoietin will be triggering the production of erythropoiesis. Okay, so you should know this, everyone should know this, so that you don't want to mug up some sort of explanation sort of questions or give reason sort of questions. Like when people are living at a higher altitude, why do they have, when people are in lower altitude, when they are going to higher altitude, why do they have hypoxia, or why do they get hypoxia, or how come the situation is getting corrected within 2 or 3 days? So this is the answer. Okay, so it's about us, right? So we don't want to think about syllabus, it's about our body. So you have to know what is happening inside our body. Up to a little more you can learn. You don't want to be like normal, you can learn a little more, right? So and one more thing, when we sleep, the RBC count goes low. How come it is becoming lower? Or what is the reason for this, or how come this is possible? Is at the time of our sleep, RBC production is little lowered. The rate of RBC production becomes very low. The reason is most of our organs are not vigorously working, as like how do we work at while we awake. So we doesn't need that much amount of RBC. So naturally this RBC production used to go low at the time of sleep. Nearly some 5% it's used to go low. Okay, so that's it about this RBC. And then we discussed about WBC, the types and the subcategories also, and why do they have such a name, and what are the characteristics, right? This diagram is important. This diagram, without color, you can copy this, you can draw this diagram. Everyone should draw this diagram, please. And characteristics we have studied. And your homework for today is you have to learn this lesson till WBC gets over, till the function and origin and life of WBC, right? So this is your homework. I guess you understand everything, and I need you to send the notes to me. Till now I'm not receiving notes from most of you guys. If you are not sending, even after this video, I will make a call to your number. And I will remind you that. And I understand that you are not watching the video so completely. So that's why you are missing that. Go through that and take the notes and send the copy of notes that what you are writing to me through WhatsApp. Okay, this is third time I'm asking. Most of the kids are doing. Not everyone. Most of the kids are doing. Still some kids are not doing. Next video, let me name you. Okay. Right, so I guess you will do that. I need notes from all the students. Thank you, kids. Complete your work and be safe at home. Thank you.